Vårt liv består av en lång serie känslomässiga upplevelser och kriser.
Ytligt sett är kriserna mindre påtagliga i den här sortens miljö än i denna.
Den brittiske läkaren R.D. Lang vållade stor debatt för en del år sedan med påståendet att det är de som helt anpassar sig till den värld nutidsmänniskan skapat som är sjuka. Att må illa, menar han, till kropp och själ av den här sortens tillvaro, det är egentligen en sund reaktion.
How do you like your job environment?
Well, the job environment is very stressful because you're dealing with the public and it's a job where we are issuing some of this to people and it causes a lot of problems.
It doesn't make you nervous with all this traffic?
No, I'm used to it.
You're used to it?
I was born and raised here.
Home all the time?
Right.
It's crazy. I drive from Manhattan to Queens every morning to drive my son to school and it takes you about an hour and 45 minutes. When there's no traffic, it takes about 15 minutes.
It all depends on the driver themselves being understanding that the volume of traffic is too heavy for the amount of the width of the street. So
instead of getting better, it's getting worse.
It's getting worse, yeah. How does it make you feel?
I don't take it with a grain of salt.
But I mean, eventually, stress is something that we have to deal with every day, and stress does make people sick after a while. Yeah.
Men var vi än bor, vad vi än arbetar med och hur vi än lever, så drabbas vi ändå alla av sorg och glädje, motgång och framgång, av starka känsloupplevelser. De positiva händelserna har vi relativt lätt att handskas med, men mot besvikelserna och mot stressen i livet står vi ofta oskyddade och oförberedda. Det kan gälla allt ifrån en idrottsförlust till förlusten av ett jobb, eller förlusten av en livskamrat, eller förlusten i tidiga år av en förälder med negativa psykiska verkningar tvärs genom hela det vuxna livet.
Att sådana händelser åstadkommer känslomässiga störningar är vi naturligtvis medvetna om. Men att psykiska tryck av detta slag ofta också ger oss rent kroppsliga svåra sjukdomar, det är ännu inte lika välbekant. Och därmed är vi inne på de psykosomatiska sjukdomar som våra tre program ska handla om. Och då är det inte tal om inbillade sjukdomar, utan om delvis allvarliga sådana, ibland med dödlig utgång. Redan i det gamla Kina och i det gamla Rom insåg man att balansen mellan kropp och själ var avgörande för människans hälsa. Cicero, statsman och filosof.
Känslor kan åstadkomma stora kroppsliga förändringar i människan.
Ändå skulle det ta 2000 år innan den medicinska vetenskapen på allvar började forska i dessa förhållanden.
Och ännu på 1980-talet måste man konstatera att denna forskning fortfarande endast sker på små öar här och var i det medicinska landskapet. Varför ska vi återkomma till längre fram?
We have already tried to explain how a psychosomatic illness develops through feelings from life events around us. But we do feel that there are other ways of explaining this. What is your shortest explanation of a psychosomatic illness, Professor Wolf?
Well, I think a psychosomatic illness is any illness the cause or the manifestations of are contributed to either in a major or a minor way by problems of adjustment of an individual to his life experience.
Is the psychosomatic really ill, or is he a hypochondriac?
No, he's no doubt that he's ill. Mm-hmm. I think it's important to realize that the mechanisms of illness are the same, whether they're ordered by the higher centers in the brain, or whether they occur from some other precipitating cause. mm-hmm. changes in the weather and so forth. But the changes that occur in the body, be it the heart or the stomach or kidney or whatnot, are brought about by the same process. So it's a real illness.
What is your shortest explanation of a psychosomatic illness?
Well, the shortest is that any illness is psychosomatic because of the mind-body connection.
It's an illness in which the distress of the patient seems to be most powerfully determined by feelings and attitudes that that patient has been experiencing and has modified the function of his tissues.
Professor Wolf, percentage-wise, how many illnesses do you think are psychosomatic?
It's really a matter of degree. And some of the commonest diseases, such as coronary disease, bowel troubles, peptic ulcer, are diseases that are very common and are very commonly heavily dependent on psychosomatic influences. It's easy to think of psychosomatic phenomena if you think of how the body reacts in anticipation. If you pass a restaurant and you see some delicious food in there, your salivary glands are likely to act up and you flow. Well, this is a psychosomatic response mm-hmm. because there's been no stimulation of the salivary glands except by a sensation of pleasure about food. The runner who stands at the starting point has already his cardiovascular system, his heart and blood vessels, operating as if he were already running. So we frequently refer to psychosomatic phenomena, changes in the body, including illness, as reactions as if. And there was a famous Norwegian philosopher whose name was Hans Weyinger, who wrote a book called The Philosophy of As If. And I have a copy of that. It's a fascinating one.
Percentage-wise, how many illnesses do you think are psychosomatic?
By definition, I say 100% of all illnesses are psychosomatic. Even broken bones, because of the mind-body connection. However, in order not to have it be an absurd answer, I have to say that certain illnesses have a greater connection to psychological factors. Now, traditionally, we include high blood pressure and asthma and peptic ulcer as some of the major illnesses that have a large component of a psychological causation. But the more we learn, the more illnesses fall under that category. For example, even infectious disease is connected to psychological impairment. If a person is under stress, their immune response that allows one to fight infectious organisms is impaired. Mm-hmm. So having a cold is a psychosomatic illness. Mm-hmm.
You already mentioned the coronary heart disease, bowel troubles, peptic ulcer, high blood pressure as some of the psychosomatic diseases. What are some of the other most common ones?
Well, some of the very common ones are in the skin, like hives, urticaria, mm-hmm. and eczema, mm-hmm. very heavily contributed to, and also by allergies, you see. Mm-hmm. These things work together, but they work along the same pathways. So the skins are common. There are eye diseases that are also involved, not too surprising when you know the tear ducts are reflectors of one's emotional life.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
So you can look really at almost any part of the body.
Well, I would have thought the most common are muscle tension headaches and gastrointestinal complaints of abdominal pain that very much resemble the difficulties of either ulcer or irritable colon. And probably also severe muscle spasms involving lower back and legs that give rise to back pain.
Ryggbesvär, magont, hudsjukdomar, hjärt- och kärlsjukdomar, astma och huvudvärk är alltså några av de vanligaste psykosomatiska sjukdomarna.
Och vi ska nu träffa en kvinna i New York som länge hade en av dessa sjukdomar.
A spastic intestine.
You have it still, or you?
No, I don't.
How can you describe the pains you had?
The pain was extremely severe. The very first time I had it, I was in the hospital visiting my daughter, mm-hmm. who was very ill. So I was under quite a bit of stress. And what happened, I didn't realize I was under that much stress. I knew I was upset, but I doubled over with pain in the hospital.
Oh.
And I was with my family doctor. They put me in a bed. They thought at first I had an appendicitis attack.
Yeah.
And it turned out he examined me, and it was a spastic intestine, which he felt was the result of all the stress that I was undergoing. My daughter was there and very, very ill.
Yeah.
And there was other stresses in my life at that time.
And how did you get rid of it? When?
At that point, they had to give me medication.
Yeah.
There was no way they could have done it without the medication. Eventually, then, I went for therapy.
Oh?
So that I didn't have to take
Who
the medication.
Who gave you that idea?
The doctor.
Uh-huh.
My family doctor.
Yeah.
Because I didn't want to be on medication for the rest of my life.
No.
I didn't want to have the special diet that they
offered you.
Prescribed for
yeah.
me. And he felt that if I went and had someone to talk this over with, went in for some marriage counseling perhaps,
yeah.
some type of therapy, that would relieve the symptoms, because he felt it was just...
What did you find in the therapy? Was it a lot of stress, or stress of different kinds, or was it a special sort of stress, or
I guess it was
life events?
I guess it was basically the stress in a particular situation.
Mm-hmm.
I have a feeling that people who get this are people, I know I was one of them, I'm not like that any longer. You have to be super, super at what you're doing. Super mother, super wife,
mm-hmm.
super committee lady, super teacher,
uh-huh.
super hostess. So you put a lot of the stress on yourself too,
yeah, yeah.
right? And that's how I was leading my life. Everything had to be perfection, the house, everything, you know? And I think...
And you found that out in the therapy.
Yes. It's impossible for one individual to function that way.
Do you know why you got this in your stomach and not somewhere else?
Well, the doctor said that this type of... Well, lots of people have these things, right?
Mm-hmm.
But what it is that any illness of a mental nature attacks the weakest part of the body.
That's
and
right.
the weakest part of the body was my intestines. Yeah. And this was the doctor who brought me into the world, so he knew my whole life history. He was a family friend as well as a family physician.
So the therapy helped you to heal.
Oh, your tremendously
body.
So. Yeah,
it
I would
helped
say.
Helped you in many other ways too, perhaps.
Yes.
Yeah.
But after the first year, I didn't take the medication any longer. The second year, I was still having some problems. And I think with the therapy, I think you weaken yourself. I do think you do weaken yourself physically slightly. So that what happens is, if I'm under a lot of stress now, that is the part that will bother me, but now I'm able to control it myself. My mind controls what's going on. I'm not letting the body take over completely, the physical aspect,
Does
the mental.
Does it sometimes happen, though, that the body...
I can feel it. You
yeah.
get a little warning sign yeah. that this is going to start acting up again. And what I do is I remove myself, if I can, physically from the situation. If I can't do it physically, mentally, I psych myself out of it.
How do you think it should develop if you hadn't gone to a therapist?
Oh, I think that what they said would have happened. I would have continued with the spastic intestine, then I probably would have developed the diverticulosis, then I probably would have had the operation. I would have lived with this horrendous diet for the rest of my life. I would have been thin, but I would have been miserable. I think that's what would have happened. And I think a lot of doctors, I can say this, I hope, a lot of doctors do not suggest with therapy.
No. I just got some pills.
Yeah, because most people like to take the pills. It's easy. The therapy is hard, right?
Om man nu hittar den psykiska orsaken till en fysisk sjukdom och kan neutralisera eller skydda sig mot den utlösande känslomässiga upplevelsen, så kan alltså de fysiska besvären helt försvinna. Professor Stuart Wolf kan ge oss fler exempel på detta, men låt oss först ganska grundligt presentera denne man, sedan länge en av världens ledande forskare i psykosomatisk medicin och huvudmedverkande i våra tre program.
Dr. Wolfs första stora forskarinsats var det mångåriga studiet av Tom, något som blev en inkörsport för hela hans livslånga intresse för psykosomatiska fenomen. Och här låter vi några klipp ur en film som Oklahoma-universitetet gjort berätta.
Tom, tell me in your own words how you happened to get this opening into your stomach.
Well, when I was a little boy, but 9 years old, I swallowed some scalding hot clam chowder.
Clam chowder? What did you think it was, Tom?
Well, the way the can felt, I thought it was beer.
You thought it was beer? Well, what was done? What happened?
And I fell on the floor unconscious.
And what happened then?
After I come to, everybody was coming in trying to do something so I could swallow. But there was nothing anybody could do. So the doctors had to go to work and make an incision in my stomach and leave it that way so I could feed.
And you were 9 years old. How long ago was that, Tom?
1895.
And since that time you fed yourself?
I have.
Has it interfered with you, Tom?
No, not in the least.
Were you able to do sports as a youngster?
Yes, played baseball, football, and then I went to work at all trades. And then I got married, I got a daughter, and a granddaughter.
Could you work and support the family?
Absolutely.
That's wonderful, Tom. The record of his operation at the New York Hospital in 1895 shows that Tom went sour on the operating table. And that's why his fistula is so large and has to be covered by gauze pads and a bandage. For the experimenter, this is fortunate, because Tom's fistula is unique since it gives an unimpeded view of a large section of the gastric mucosa. Here is a close-up of it, looking very healthy. By a slight increase in abdominal pressure, more of the membrane can be brought into view. When we hadn't seen Tom for several months, we discovered a lesion on his gastric mucosa, which grew with extraordinary rapidity. It turned out to be an adenocarcinoma. It was excised by the surgeon, and in the latest pictures of Tom, you can see the stay sutures still in place. This x-ray shows Tom's stomach. The fistula is located about two-thirds of the way between cardia and pylorus. Notice how the greater curvature is rotated forward. 2 hours after the barium meal, the stomach is emptied normally, and most of the barium is in the intestine. The obstructed esophagus ends in a cul-de-sac. It holds about 100 cc's of liquid and must be emptied periodically. As Tom has told you himself, his handicap did not prevent him from supporting himself and his family. Tom was proud of his independence. In his youth, he even played football. Only feeding was a little complicated. Tom feeds himself through an ordinary kitchen funnel inserted into the opening of his stomach. Funnel's connected with a rubber tube, which is notched at the end so that it can be inserted easily into the opening. Tom, would you put the tube into your stomach, please, to show us how you take your dinner. Once the tube has been inserted, Tom chews his food, pretty much the same sort of food you or I might eat, and then spits it directly into the funnel and into his stomach. We were naturally eager to learn as much as possible from the accessible stomach of Tom. First, we studied the appearance of the mucosa under all sorts of conditions, with the naked eye, the hand lens, and the dissecting microscope. Then we correlated these observations with measurements of secretion and motor activity. Next, we studied the mechanism protecting the stomach against the activity of its own digestive juices. And later on, we studied the effects of drugs in various phases of gastric activity. And finally, we obtained a running insight into the complex reactions of the stomach to various psychologically important events and stresses. Tom, when you left town, you had no idea that they had in mind some plan about retirement?
No.
Did anybody say anything to you at all?
No.
Well, what actually happened then after you left town?
When the paymaster came to Oklahoma, that's the first sunshine that I saw.
What was that?
He gave me my last check. What? I didn't have to call for it.
He sent it to you?
He sent it to me.
And you had no suspicion of this before?
No, no.
Did you speak to him about it?
No.
Suppose you had mentioned it to him, what
would
you say?
He'd lie.
As we began this interview, which was concerned with a very serious personal problem of Tom's, the membrane was of average color and turgor with several folds in view. After several minutes of discussion of his forced retirement, the membrane blushed and the folds thickened and merged. Motor activity was also increased. Here we can see the profound changes in Tom's stomach with various psychological states. Fear. Relative serenity. And anger. When Tom reacted to a situation with feelings of dejection and despair, his stomach was pale and underactive. And sometimes this hypofunctioning state lasted for many days or weeks. But Tom, being an Irishman, responded to most of life's challenges with his fists up.
Why was it that you had to look after these grandchildren, Tom? What happened?
Well, we were determined to take them out of the home.
And how did they happen to be in the home?
The mother placed them there.
Mm-hmm.
And under these circumstances, his stomach became overactive, the membrane engorged with blood, with increased production of acid and increased motor activity. And this hyperfunctioning state sometimes also lasted for periods of days or weeks. And this situation, of course, is more hazardous for the gastrointestinal tract because, as we pointed out, the membrane is more fragile and easily damaged when it's hyperactive. Now, other individuals might respond to the same type of situation in a fashion opposite from Tom, depending on how they interpreted the threat. When a person cannot interpret his surroundings, and the stomach hence cannot react to life stresses, there's only a basic rhythm of motility and secretory activity. This record, showing cyclic acid production, comes from a fistulous individual who, through an accident, was also physiologically decorticate. There's an additional and interesting observation I'd like to report. When Tom did not have the psychological satisfaction of enjoying his food, when food was placed directly into the funnel without being tasted, he lost weight. This implies that some aspects of metabolic balance are influenced by the meaning of life experiences. In appraising the results of these studies, the most important contribution was to add another element to Cannon's concept that emotional stress causes gastric hypofunction. Tom has taught us that not only hypofunction, but also the potentially more dangerous hyperfunction of the stomach may occur in reaction to stressful life experiences. Thank you.
professor Wolfs andra över hela den medicinska världen uppmärksammade forskningsarbete bestod av det som ska fylla hela det andra programmet i denna serie. Nämligen kartläggningen av hur och varför den lilla italienpräglade småstaden Rosetto i Pennsylvania söder om New York var helt fri från hjärtinfarkter och psykiska sjukdomar hos de som var 60 år och yngre. Detta arbete följdes upp på 70-talet och en andra uppföljning ska nu strax påbörjas. Denna säregna stad ska vi alltså återkomma till, liksom till utredningen och boken om fenomenet.
Stuart Wolf var först ung professor vid Cornell Medical School i New York och därefter har han lett forskning, undervisning och uppbyggnad av fakulteter vid universitet i Texas, Oklahoma och i staten Pennsylvania.
Han är en svuren fiende till utslagningen av allt yngre grupper av folk på arbetsmarknaden och till den generella pensioneringen av människor, ibland i deras bästa år. Han betraktar dessa moderna fenomen som ett av civilisationens värsta gissel, en ordning som lika ofta skapar depressioner som avkoppling och harmoni. För egen del har han avskaffat begreppet pensionering. 70 år gammal är han alltjämt professor och undervisare, och en hel obruten arbetsdag i veckan ägnar han åt patienter på ett sjukhus i stålstaden Bethlehem. Men framförallt är han chef för det forskningslaboratorium utanför staden Bangor som han inrättade för unga sommarlediga mediciner från hela Amerika redan på 1950-talet och som nu utvecklats till ett Institute for Human Ecology, för människomiljövård på svenska.
One last Rosetta budget, I hope you found that.
Med hustru Virginia som skattmästare och två sekreterare som närmaste medhjälpare.
Institutet är byggt på den mark som paret Wolf köpte som ett enkelt sommarställe redan 1947 och som man undan för undan byggt till. Trots många medicinska sysslor hinner makarna ta aktiv del i skötseln av de 60 tunnlanden lantbruk och dessutom koppla av vid den pool som de båda byggt med egna händer.
And the tennis court is your own work too?
Yes, actually that was sort of homemade as well. We smoothed it out and dug it out and then put stones, small stones in there and left them for a matter of 2 or 3 years. And I can advise you that that's the important way to do it.
Thank you.
Because it allows the stones to find their level and they won't sink anymore. Then you've got a tennis court that stays level.
How old is he?
Oh, it's probably 25 years.
Still great.
Still in good shape.
Stuart Wolf reser alltjämt världen runt på vetenskapliga konferenser. Han har varit i Sverige flera gånger och både ringen på handen och dokument på väggen berättar om att han är hedersdoktor i Göteborg.
Yes, absolutely.
Bilder visar också att han har flitig kontakt med svenska läkare och vetenskapsmän, professor Gunnar Björk till exempel.
This is Gunnar here standing with Torres Theorell. That's at the time of Torres's defense of his thesis.
Oh, I see.
And I was his opponent. Down below is Lars Werke with his beautiful wife the ceremony
when you became a doctor.
Yes, of the honorary degree. Ulf von Euler, he happened to be visiting us at the time of the news that he'd won the Nobel Prize.
Oh, really?
He talked on the phone and came back and sat down just as if the information was something about the timing of the airplane or something of that sort. I'm sure he was very gratified, but he was a very modest man.
You had a migrant patient once in New York. Tell us briefly how you helped him to find a psychological background himself.
Well, it was a very amusing experience. I was working with probably the most famous headache person in the world, whose name was Harold Wolf. He had an extra name, F on his name.
Mm-hmm.
We weren't related, but I worked with him for 14 years.
So the place was very well known for headaches and headache treatments. And this fine-looking gentleman came in, took a seat in my office, and with a big, broad smile, he said, I understand that you think that dealing with one's personal problems is the cause of headaches. I'm here to prove that you're wrong. Well, I just smiled and asked him a little bit and asked him how he knew that. He said, well, because when I get my headaches, it's usually at the symphony. I go to the symphony every Thursday, and every Thursday I get a headache. And I love music, so obviously you're incorrect. I said, well, tell me a little bit more. How does it happen you're so interested in music? And he told me the story of how he'd grown up in Central Europe, how he wanted to be a violinist, wanted to give his life to music, but his father poo-pooed the idea, said, that's a nice hobby, but you can't earn a living that way. Get yourself a job. So this fellow was, you might say, frustrated at an early age, and he finally came to this country. He did have a job, and eventually he became head of a women's dress manufacturing company. Mm-hmm. But the interesting thing was that as he was telling me this story, and every time he'd go to the symphony, his head would start to hurt. He, of course, realized that all of the old frustrations and anger had welled up inside of him. He laughed.
As he told you about it, he realized it.
As he told me, and he laughed.
When he found the cause of this, did the headache come back, the migraine come back when he attended concerts later?
That was the last time he had a headache at the concert. That particular experience apparently adjusted his reaction enough so that he could go to the concert without a headache. He had other headaches. It came on under other kinds of circumstances.
Pressure.
And we worked together, and he began to understand. He apologized for his opening remarks.
That was a challenge, wasn't it?
But
is there a migrant personality?
I think it's fair to say that. It's hard to define what a personality is, but I think one can say that patients who have migraine are similar to one another. And they're easily recognized by a person who's experienced with headaches. These people are individuals who take responsibility seriously and who do not want to be criticized. They sort of devote their lives to being above criticism. Many people call them perfectionists, and they are perfectionists in areas that they consider are important.
If I came to you and said, I know I'm a diabetic, how can you best help me? How would you know whether my diabetic is psychosomatic or not? You can't take it for granted, I assume.
No, you certainly can't take it for granted.
How can you find out that it's psychosomatic granted?
The only way to find out is to get to know you.
Yes, that's a long talk.
It's a long talk. And not to assume that you would react to things the way I do, but rather to ask you to tell me a little bit about your life, how the world looks to you, what it was like as you grew up. And once you get someone talking, you begin to know them.
It makes you much more an interviewer than I and Britt are.
Well, the interviewing is fundamental to this process.
Yeah.
And it isn't just the events that take place in life, how many troubles you've had, but it's your response to, your attitude toward these changes in your life that make the difference. Johns Hopkins had as a professor, as the professor of psychiatry, Adolf Meyer, who was a psychiatrist who had a great respect for biology and the the physiological mechanisms that are involved in the manifestations of stress. And he was a genius at interviewing. Oddly enough, he wrote very poorly.
Mm-hmm.
He wrote these German sentences that went on for half a page and then had a verb at the end. And it was very difficult to read him,
mm-hmm.
and he didn't write much. But he used to interview patients mm-hmm. in front of the whole class. And the skill with which he was able to make the patient feel comfortable, to give the patient the sense, the immensely important sense that you're safe, that whatever you say or do in front of me, there's no danger of ridicule or censure or betrayal. And you could see the patients sort of feel comfortable, and then their reaction to this room full of eager faces was not, oh, these people are spying on me, but I must be important.
So there
what I have must be significant. Dr. Meyer is very interested in me.
Mm-hmm.
And
that was the way you learned it.
So this was the way I learned.
But was that very common at your time?
No.
In your time?
No.
No.
There was very little of that taught in mm-hmm. medical schools.
Let's ask some younger American doctors about these matters. Have you had any training in psychosomatic illnesses?
No, not yet.
Will you get it, that you know?
They give us some classes in psychosomatic illnesses. They the first 2 years of medical school here, we get psychology and psychiatry
uh-huh.
sprinkled in the curriculum.
Yeah.
And uh-huh. so we touch on it.
Yeah.
And then later on there are electives in psychosomatic
illnesses. Will you get some training in having long talks with a patient to find out whether
yes.
they suffer from a psychosomatic illness? Is that the psychology and that
yeah.
you get the first year?
Yeah, that's where we get the talks on that. But there's rarely very little time
yeah.
where you get to do that. I mean, you get the training, but you hardly ever get to practice it.
It was a good introduction. It helped us to be aware of some of the problems that some of these patients are going through. But I feel we didn't have quite an adequate training in that. I think we could get more.
How to talk to a patient has been well taught. Role that psychosomatic illness plays in health has not been emphasized.
It has not.
But the long discussions have been.
Yeah. You feel that it should be more emphasized in the training?
That's an important part of people's health.
Yes, it is, isn't it?
We did have some conversation about conversion reactions and interviewing with patients.
Yeah. You feel it was enough for you? Was it enough of training in that area?
No. In medical school, during the psychiatric rotation, they teach you about all the different diseases that might be psychiatrically related, so we were taught.
Did they also train you in having long talks with a patient to find out whether they might suffer from that type of an illness?
There's a new emphasis that I found when I was a medical student on getting to know the patient better. And talking more and trying to get a whole picture, like bringing in the families and talking with the other members of the family also. So I thought there was a new emphasis on it.
Very good. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Thanks.
Professor Wolf, is it important that a patient finds out by himself that his illness might have a psychosomatic background?
I think it's very important. Very often a patient may find it out in conversation, in discussion, but won't admit it.
Mm-hmm.
That's all right.
Mm-hmm.
He implies by many things that he says and does that he does understand it,
mm-hmm.
but it's not necessary to really rub somebody's nose in it, as
mm-hmm.
it were,
mm-hmm.
As long as the message gets across.
How does the patient usually react when he does find out?
Well, it's changed a lot over the years. Patients used to be sort of irritated with themselves and hostile to the doctor.
Mm-hmm.
But since people have learned much more about how the brain controls the rest of the body and how reacting to people and events in your life control the behavior of your internal organs, most people know that now.
so that the reaction is very often very positive, and sometimes it's a great relief.
Mm-hmm.
People are glad that they don't have something that's going to carry them off right mm-hmm. away.
Thank you. Let's ask another expert on this subject, Professor Morten Bogdanoff, the same question.
When we differentiate between the illnesses that are psychologically affected and those which seemingly are not, we really unreasonably and inaccurately divide the world into two parts. Furthermore, the notion that a given set of complaints is predominantly influenced by one's feelings, and use the term psychosomatic in almost invariably when it's recited to the patient, is heard as a psychiatric illness. And in the Western world at the present time, psychiatric illness is still predominantly viewed not so much as an illness as an indictment. And people are extraordinarily uncomfortable, more often than not, to have their complaints be classified into the psychiatric realm. It's an unfortunate attitude on the part of society, and in some respects shared by the profession, because in effect, the only effective methodology we now have for the repair of psychological distress are the methods that psychiatry and its allied disciplines use. So that it's important in the practice of clinical medicine to not make that separation between psychosomatic and non-psychosomatic illness so as to maintain a what has become popularly termed a holistic approach, in which really a universal approach is being utilized, in which the realm of both psychology and internal medicine in its true pathological pattern is all of a part, one singular part.
What does a patient say to this?
What was your first reaction when you understood that your illness came from your head, so to say?
I could see where he was probably very, very right, knowing what had happened throughout my life, knowing what I was going through then,
yeah
that would be very logical.
You were not annoyed by that message and by that?
Oh, no.
Do you think that people in general that have no possibility to have such a trustful friend to a doctor, how do you think they react when they get to know all of a sudden that the illness, bodily illness, is caused by psychological things?
I think truthfully the majority of people do not go along with that. Mm-hmm. I think the majority of people, even very well educated people, prefer to take medication rather than go into any kind of therapy, because the therapy is long, drawn out, painful. The medication is quick, particularly in the United States. Mm-hmm. Everyone wants a quick answer. I mean, if they go into therapy, they want it done in a week. Do you know what I mean?
And do you think that is right or wrong? I mean,
oh, impossible, wrong. You know, but it's really, it's the person who has to go into therapy most sometimes is the person that doesn't. As I said, I think that I tried to do everything so very, very well. Now, how can I admit to myself that I'm not really all I thought I was and I need therapy? That's a little hard sometimes. But I was able to, you know, buy that and do that. Whereas I think a lot of people, and take the medicine. They're going to a specialist on Park Avenue and he tells them take the medication. And very few doctors, I think, advise you to go to therapy. I have one doctor, when I told him this is what I was going to do, he said, you'd have nothing wrong with you. You're perfectly normal and sane. Don't waste your time and your money.
Vi har redan fått ett par exempel på vad det kan vara för händelser i en människas liv som väcker så starka känslor att vi kan bli fysiskt sjuka. Två läkare på den amerikanska västkusten, Dr. Thomas Holmes i Seattle och Dr. Richard Ray i San Diego, gjorde för ett antal år sedan en skala från toppvärdet 100
och ner till 11 på händelser som kan förändra vårt liv.
När för många händelser av detta slag inträffar allt för tätt, då är man i riskzonen för svåra sjukdomar.
Framgångar till synes positiva händelser alltså kan skapa stress. En befordran till exempel med kraftigt ökad inkomst.
Alla förändringar av vår dagliga rutin innebär också risker för vår hälsa. I synnerhet om vi tvingas till många förändringar på en och samma gång.
Längst ner ännu två exempel på företeelser som allmänt betraktas som positiva men som ändå innebär stress.
Om man nu i nästan alla tider inom läkarnas krets känt till sambandet mellan själ och kropp, varför har man så här sent börjat forska på detta område? Professor Bogdanoff i New York.
Well, I think the major reason is that the methods for examining the psychological characteristics of the human organism, and we're talking about human research at the moment, that those methods are still relatively unsophisticated. And as 20th century sciences evolve, the important thing is to be precise and quite definitive in what you can measure and to be as quantifiable as possible. And the characteristics of the central nervous system function that we call emotions and feelings do not as yet lend themselves to that precision of measurement and quantification that 20th century science demands.
Hard to get numbers.
Extraordinarily difficult to get numbers. They're broad estimates. They're never precise. How much despair does one experience? What is the meaning of the intensity of fear? What's the sense of grief? How does one measure that and then relate that to the orders of change that occur in the tissues? Very extreme, very difficult to do. Whereas tissue changes, of course, can be much more precisely measured, and it doesn't take long before the laboratories that devote themselves to those relationships soon become tremendously interested in the details of the tissue change and not stay on course with the emphasis on psychological phenomena.
What about the other side of it? Does it pay for a doctor to get involved in this?
Well, the amount of,
I mean, in a wider view, not only money, also award and everything.
Right, the prestige that comes, that is dispensed, and honors that are dispensed in the profession of investigative medicine have been awarded far more broadly to other fields and not to the field of psychophysiologic interests. And I think,
why is that?
I think that has to do with the fact that the science doesn't seem, quote, as hard, close quote, as it does in other realms. And the immediate utility, the likelihood that the observations will result in some major therapeutic or diagnostic advance has not emerged.
The other thing is that if you look at the organs, the organ that is the most difficult to approach,
the most complex to unravel is the brain.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So that only very recently have we gotten the means, the mechanisms, mm-hmm. whereby we can study the circuits of the brain and begin to not just speculate, but actually to document the pathways in the brain that govern all the organs of the body.
So you look forward to a quick development.
The progress right now is breathtaking.
Since most illnesses come from the mind and they do demand deep, long talks between the doctor and the patients, how will it be possible for such care these days with our giant hospitals where the patient seldom gets to talk to the same doctor more than once or twice? How will the personal care evolve?
Well, two things might happen to make that work out. One is that the patient population themselves may become sufficiently educated and informed so as to press upon the medical profession that that's a necessary part of medical care, and in effect not to pay the bill until they get the service that they feel is requisite as part of medical care. The other facet, of course, is that other disciplines who aid in the care of patients, that fill out the staffs of medical care facilities, nurses, psychologists, social workers, all the individuals who are co-professionals and who are educated on how to talk and how to listen to patients and help them understand their problems, these people play larger roles in the functioning of those medical centers. The fact that the technological advances are pressing hard on medicine, and the hardware and the equipment and the various diagnostic procedures, which tend to dehumanize seemingly and to make more machinery-like the character of the medical center, and therefore put into less prominent a role the interpersonal characteristics of the doctor-patient interaction. That all will gradually, I think, shake out in time, in which there'll probably be more non-technical machinery people operating in the medical center and more of the interpersonal factors evolving into the hands of the physicians. It has to be the most satisfying part of the work of the physician, the relationship with people.
And yes, physicians have to spend time with their patients. They have to talk with the patients, get to understand the patients, but if they're going to assign the task of history taking to someone else, some assistant, and then come in and consider their job is to order tests and to write prescriptions, they're going to practice according to, you might say, averages. Mm-hmm. What do most people who have such and such a disease need? They need these tests and these prescriptions. But people are individuals, mm-hmm. and in order to fit the treatment to the person, the physician has to understand the patient. Yeah. It's a little bit like Procrustes' bed. You remember Procrustes? He had a house by the side of the road, and he welcomed visitors, and he always gave them a fine dinner with wine, and then he showed them up to their room to spend the night, and the bed was a certain length. And if the visitor, the traveler, fit exactly into that bed, he could simply have a nice night's sleep, wake up early in the morning, and take off on his travels. If, on the other hand, his legs were too long for the bed, they would be cut off just at the margin of the bed. Or if he was too short to fill the bed, they would pull him out. And this is the way many medical problems are addressed, with an attempt to solve them with Procrustes' bed, fitting the patient to our system rather than fitting our system to the patient.
Vi är fortfarande rädda för det som har med psykiska sjukdomar att göra. Även om vi innerst inne förstår att många av dessa besvär hänger ihop med den miljö vi själva skapat och oftast själva valt att leva i. Vi talar gärna öppet om sånt här i allmänna ordalag, inte minst i radio, i tv och i pressen. Men när någon verkligen får psykiska problem så är det alltjämt mycket hysch-hysch.
Kommer denna inställning att ändras om vi gör klart för oss och kan acceptera att praktiskt taget alla sjukdomar och skador, även snuva och benbrott, har psykiska orsaker? Låt oss till slut be professor Stuart Wolf rikta sig direkt till oss angående denna rädsla.
Well, I think everyone has psychological problems. And to not be afraid is first to understand a little. One isn't embarrassed about shivering if one is out in the cold. And yet the body is susceptible to all kinds of influences, including the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune. They say that sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt me. Words are very often what hurt most. Why is that? It's because all of the organs of the body are connected to the brain. The brain regulates automatically our breathing and our heartbeat and our kidney function and the way the liver takes care of the crazy things that we eat. But all of these functions are capable of being regulated and controlled by the same areas of the brain that interpret life experience. This is why people cry, why people blush, why the inner organs will get in a turmoil or get sick from a life experience. So the step is to recognize one's own feelings, to be honest about them, and to realize that everybody needs help at some time. Everybody has troubles at some time. And the way we get on over troubles is depending on each other and depending on professional help.